Okay, so I want to go over the main idea, the main argument from Meditation 3, now that we have the motivations for him writing Meditation 3. And so Descartes is going to offer kind of argument in Meditation 3 to prove God's existence. And here's how it goes. Here's one way of stating the argument. Well, it seems as though I've proven, Descartes says, that I exist. But I have to escape solipsism, I have to know about these clear and distinct ideas, whether or not they're true. What other ideas do I have that I could investigate or subject to a kind of inquiry? And there's a particular kind of idea that he comes across in Meditation 3. And it's the idea of infinity. He says, I have this idea of infinity, but where could I have gotten this idea from? And he comes up with three options for where he could have gotten this idea. He says, well, did I get this idea of infinity from the world? But it seems, he says, no. It doesn't seem like one could get the idea of infinity from the physical world for at least two reasons. First, remember, everything that he's been doubting via his senses, as I've emphasized a lot. All of that is unreliable, it's untrustworthy. We can't distinguish when our senses are deceiving us and when they're not. So the world seems untrustworthy in virtue of sense perceiving to give me the idea of infinity. But here's the other reason. Even if my senses were intact, it's not obvious that we would experience the idea of infinity anywhere in the world. All we seem to see in the world are fairly discrete objects, which are contained in one way or another. We just experience bodies, not infinity. And so it doesn't seem like I could have gotten this idea from the world, he says. Here's the second option. Maybe I got this idea for myself. Maybe I invented it, or I've imagined it, or I'm somehow the source of the idea. But he says here that no, that can't be the case either. Why could I have not come up with the idea of infinity? He asks. Well, because I'm a finite being. I'm mortal. And if I'm a finite being, I couldn't have come up with the idea of infinity. A finite being wouldn't have the capacity or the power to come up with an infinite idea. And so I can't be the source of this idea of infinity. In fact, the only kind of thing that would have the capacity or the power to implant in me this idea of infinity would have to be an infinite being itself. And so, if I couldn't have gotten it from the world and I couldn't have gotten the idea from myself, I must have gotten this idea of infinity from an infinite being who, again, implanted it in my mind, as in particular an innate idea. And so, given that I've looked at these three options, it looks as though it is only this option which is a real one. Insofar as I have this idea of infinity, it must have come from an infinite being. And therefore, an infinite being, namely God, must exist in order to understand how I could have this idea of infinity. And so that is one way of stating how Descartes attempts to prove God's existence in Meditation 3. Now, in Meditation 5, he offers a, I'm not going to go over this in detail, but one could do it in a very similar fashion. He doesn't rely on the idea of infinity in Meditation 5, but he relies upon the idea of perfection. Again, to prove God's existence as a perfect being. And in fact, that's the one that Simon Blackburn speaks more of in his commentary on Descartes, more so than the idea of infinity. And again, now, if that argument goes through, if God exists, that solves both problems for Descartes that motivated Meditation 3. It gets him out of solipsism because God exists, and it allows God, who's omnibenevolent and all good, to underwrite and guarantee that Descartes' clear instinct ideas are actually true. And so, in using this foundation, in using the skeptical method to get to a foundation of the I, and then to God's existence, Descartes is able to get back to the world, to reinstate that while he might be deceived sometimes, he's largely not deceived about the world. And so, in using this foundation, he's able, he thinks, to build back up the kind of knowledge that we would want, say, in both theological aspects and in virtue of a foundation for the sciences that he was hoping for. So, one thing you might ask yourself so far is, what do you think about these ideas? What do you think about these arguments? About this rejection of an Aristotelian notion of what a human is, a human nature, about whether that piece of wax example is an accurate one, if it's a good one, or somehow that could be challenged. If this threat of solipsism is a real kind of threat that needs to be answered, or about these ideas latching onto the world, or about this this proof for God's existence. Is it a good proof or is it somehow flawed? Has he missed something? Or has he somehow smuggled in other ideas? And so all of those are questions to consider in virtue of these first three meditations. But let me offer one other objection. So last time we had seen a potential objection from Nietzsche concerning the foundation, I think, therefore I am. Here's a different kind of objection. And the objection is not against the proof of God's existence. But it's against the Cartesian project in this way. In particular, it's against that second motivation about clear instinct ideas actually latching onto the world in the way that Descartes thinks that they do. So it's known, and this is an objection, it's famously known as the Cartesian circle. And it goes pretty briefly. On the one hand, Descartes wants, I'm just going to write CD, to use his clear and distinct ideas in order to get to the existence of God. For example, the idea of infinity, in order to help prove God's existence. On the other hand, he needs God's existence in order to underwrite and guarantee that those clear and distinct ideas are actually true. And so it's called a circle, this Cartesian circle, because it is a kind of chicken and egg scenario. The question is, which comes first? If he needs clear and distinct ideas in order to prove God's existence, but he also needs God's existence to prove that clear and distinct ideas are actually true, which comes first? And there's a way to take that question. The question is not which comes first in terms of, say, a temporality or a cosmology. Somebody could, I think, easily say, well, obviously God comes first, because then God implants the idea of infinity in Descartes' mind. And then he has the idea which he gains clarity and distinctness about. But the objection isn't about a temporal which comes first. It's about the order of justification. Which of these comes first in the order of justification? Because all of this justification, all this of this method of reasoning, has relied upon this kind of foundation and this building back up in a sequential, almost geometric manner. And so here's a kind of analogy that people use sometimes. It seems as though when you go to apply for a job, for instance, one problem that people often have is that you often need experience in order to get a job. But you also often need a job in order to get experience. And so the question is, how do you get in if you're locked out from the outside? This is kind of an analogy to what seems to be the problem here. And so this is it's a common objection against Descartes' project. It has been tried to answer, people have tried to answer it in different ways. Simon Blackburn, in the chapter that I'm asking you to read, goes over this idea in a little more detail, if you think, or if you want to investigate whether it can be reworked in a certain way. So you should consider this as well. I'm not going to say too much about the Simon Blackburn piece. Most of this is just about Descartes as a starting point for helping us to engage as best as we can with philosophy, for giving us a starting point in the modern period, for seeing how it is that he really does challenge a kind of authority, and it's in virtue of a certain kind of individualism, which he's giving rise to. Because, as I just wrote a moment ago, he starts with the I, moves toward God, and then back to the world. And that is very different from the kind of cosmological framework in which the church or other medieval institutions would operate if you were to ask a religious believer, either today, frankly, or then, well, in the order of cosmology, how do we understand how things go? I imagine they would say, well, from God, who's always existed and always will, to the world that he creates. And then creates mankind, or a series of eyes. And so, in virtue of this alternative framework, Descartes is helping give rise, in just one way, in a philosophical way, to an individualism which starts to form part of the modern period of philosophy and starts to inform the modern period. Beyond philosophy, in history, in politics, and so on. Okay, so those are all the major kinds of ideas that I wanted to highlight from the first three meditations. I hope that you found it stimulating, and I hope you find it challenging and interesting. I want to hear your comments and what you think about these ideas. Again, Blackburn is there to help guide you through some of these. He goes into some arguments in more detail than I did, or at least in different ways than I did. There is some overlap between what he says and what I tried to explain. The only thing that I don't agree with Blackburn's commentary is you'll notice that he speaks of the Nietzschean objection that I asked us to take up last time. But he kind of dismisses it out of hand. He says it's kind of bizarre. And it might be bizarre, but I think it actually requires more of an answer than what he gives. So the rest of the chapter I think is quite good, but his dismissal or his hand waving is a little too quick. And so I think the Nietzschean objection is one that either has to be answered or has to be accepted, or somehow has to be problematized in a different kind of way. Okay, but otherwise you should read the Blackburn for your own sake. And that's the end of meditation three. So thank you.